Hey there, how's it going? By the time this video comes out, the Nokia 3310 Jam 6 will either be happening or have just happened. And I didn't actually take part. However, I did take part last year. I documented a lot of my progress with the intention of making a video about it, but I was still pretty heavy in the throes of burnout and never did. However, I like the game and you really don't care when the jam happens, right? So let's go ahead and go all the way back to 2004. I'm on a bus in San Francisco and I need something to do other than staring at people awkwardly. So I take out my cell phone to play the top of the line in mobile gaming. Truly cutting edge. In reality, it seems so simple and boring now, but I had this phone my first year of college. And traveling around the city all day with a Game Boy, even the current SP version that I had, was kind of inconvenient. So I ended up playing a lot of the built-in games on the go. Alright, let's come back to the current time. Well, not really the current time, about a year ago. I wanted to do the Nokia 3310 Jam the 2 years prior, and for some reason or another, I just wasn't able to participate. However, this time, I did have a few days open during the jam due to a 3-day weekend. The jam itself is 10 days, but that's for people who don't put too much on their own plate. And I really liked the challenge of the jam, so I jumped in to see what I could do even with the limited time frame. Let's go over the rules for the jam. The point is to make a game with some of the restrictions designers would have been faced with creating games for the Nokia 3310. The jam breaks it down into three main factors, so it's still fun and any game engine can be used. Number 1, 2-color palette. At this time, cell phones didn't have any fancy modern OLED screens with the ability of displaying millions of colors. No, no. We're talking about 1.5-inch backlit monochrome LCDs. And that measurement moves us to our next factor. Number 2. A resolution size of 84 pixels by 48 pixels. For reference, the original Game Boy was 160 by 144 pixels. And the final mechanical restriction isn't much of a concern for me because audio is always something that I rush at the end anyway, but it's good to keep it in mind. Number 3. Sound can only play one at a time, so no overlapping music or sound effects. The jam also has an optional theme, which of course I'm going to opt for. And this time that theme is fast and slow, which I think is a pretty good theme in all regards. I wanted to make a movement-oriented game, like the old top-down computer games I played as a kid. One of my favorites was always Chip's Challenge, where you use the arrow keys to move around an obstacle course-like level, avoiding dangers and collecting chips and power-ups. Because I only had 3 days, I wasn't going to have time for any power-ups, but I thought it would be fun to have some movement puzzle-type things that would fit right in on the Nokia 3310. On day one, I was able to get movement and wall collisions in pretty quickly, as well as a retro-style camera that would slide from room to room like you'd find in the old Legend of Zelda. To open the level exit, the player will need to grab all collectibles in the level. I do later change these to keys because it's more understandable that getting keys opens the door, not gathering the gem or whatever this grouping of pixels looks like to you. I'm not well practiced at working at this size with only 2 colors, so I mostly just did the drawing as I went along and hoped it looked alright. And I was able to end the day by adding some enemies that would need to be avoided. They're fairly simple, they just move forward at a pace I can set and they travel forward until they hit a wall. Then they turn around and go back in the other direction. The next day, I had to make sure that the player would be able to die if they ran into enemies.
Perfection.
And if one enemy's good, there's gotta be some more. So I created some laser beams that turn on and off that the player will have to dodge through. I also wanted to have one-way paths, like having a floor tile fall out from under you as you walk on it. But I couldn't get it to look quite right, so I ended up making a button that, when you step on it, it turns into a wall space after it stepped off. This added the only real puzzle element to the game, so at the time I thought it was needed. And since we have 2 enemies already, we might as well add a 3rd for good measure. I added a bullet-type enemy that would continually fire projectiles and would be destroyed on contact with walls. And right about now is when I wised up that the gems should actually be keys to make it a little more obvious of what they do. And with that, the basic mechanics were done. Now I just had to take all the pieces I made and put them together. I sat down making a bunch of different levels, ones where you need to thread the needle between bullets and dash between lasers, but as I built, I started worrying that everything was starting to feel a bit too samey. So I started using the one-way blocks to add some movement puzzle elements as well. This is where I think I got off the rails a little bit. I like the dodging around movement, but in my head I was thinking that the game was supposed to be a puzzle movement game. And dodging around doesn't really have any puzzle elements to it for the most part. So the game ends up being a little inconsistent with a bit of both, where the puzzle levels don't show up until later on, and I feel like I could have interspersed it a little bit more. I'm going to talk a little bit more of that, but to sum up the last day of the jam, I mostly did menus, credits, and sound effects. Nothing I ever feel is really interesting to show on a video, but it takes up time nonetheless, and it ate up the last day that I had. Alright, back to designing the levels. One thing I think I did well was create a nearly wordless tutorial for the player to introduce them to the mechanics. For example, on the first level, other than the word move for the controls, which arguably I don't actually think I need, the level starts the player on one side of the room showing a key on the other side. It's a video game. Keys are always good, so the player is most likely going to move right towards it. Either walking over the space with the X on it, showing that it's an inactive or closed space, or the player will walk around it, meaning they're aware of it, and it's something to take notice of. When the key is collected, the X changes to a circle, indicating it's now open. And with it being the only other thing in the level, the player knows that that's probably where they need to go, teaching that this is the game's 8x8 pixel representation of a locked and open door. Level 2 introduces you to dangers, which are all mostly solid pixel formations, showing that here with the classic spikes. This level is set up to teach the player to move carefully and that the door does not open unless you collect all the keys. From there, I try to introduce mechanics one by one, like the appearing walls, followed by bullets and eventually lasers and enemies. Now you can see where the fast and slow theme comes into play. Depending on the obstacles, you need to move quickly through some areas and steady through the others. Moving too fast through the bullets, for example, will just have you running into the back of another one. Overall, I actually like this game and think there could be some fun mechanics here if I scaled the idea up to something I'm more comfortable with. I do wish that I had had a bit more time to work on better planned out level design, because I'm pretty happy with the first few levels, but I feel it kind of loses its tightness as you progress. One other element that I think I would do differently now is the sliding room camera. That ended up locking me into one way that I could design levels, and I think it probably would have been better if the camera just followed the player, making levels that didn't need to adhere to a single screen size. I can't say for sure, but I like to use similar mechanics in other game jams, so if I try this one again in the future, I'll get to test my theory. If you'd like to try the game out for yourself, there's a link in the description to check it out. Thanks for letting me share this fun thing I made, and I hope you enjoyed seeing the process of it coming to life. If you want to see more game jam content, I have a playlist of all of my jam devlogs in the description, and it'll be on the screen at the end of the video. We're also getting really close to 100,000 subscribers, which is absolutely crazy to me. So if you like the video and want to see more, please hit the subscribe button, and do the bell thingy to get notified when the next video comes out. After taking a bit of a hiatus, the algorithm overlords are not smiling on me at the moment, so you may not be notified right away. Let me know in the comments if you had the Nokia 3310 at one point in your life. Or let me know if you're too young and full of life to imagine a pre-touchscreen world. I'd like to thank my Patreon supporters, especially my video producer tier patrons like See The Mess, iNight Gaming, Motzi, Nazar Salim, Pixelator Gadzi, and Warren Steven Rose. You're all awesome and I can't thank you enough. And to you, if you made it this far, thank you for watching and I appreciate you for checking out this video. I hope you have a great day or evening, whatever it is for you. I'll talk with you next time. Have a good one. Later.